congrats to you to putting all the efforts here and organizing this event. So really appreciate the invitation as well. And yeah, today we're here to talk about power-ups, but like you mentioned, the power-ups in the context of the power platform and all other tools that are part of the low-code development platform for different areas, for application development, workflow automation, business intelligence, and so on. But today's focus would be especially on power-ups as a so-called gateway to Industry 4.1. We will split the presentation in two directions, and the first step would be to discuss what actually is the Industry 4.0, 4.1, and what are the application of this term in nowadays. And then we will cover how actually the power platform and especially power apps can target the challenges of this Industry 4.1 and could solve the problems that are currently existing on the market. So we'll start with the first topic. I won't talk about me as a presenter currently. If you can scan the QR code, then you can find me in LinkedIn and continue the discussion there. But with regards to why we are here, me as Angel and Sappience as a company, actually we founded the company, me, myself, and a couple of my colleagues, part of them are currently in the conference call, last year. So we put all our efforts towards to be onboarded as soon as possible on the power apps and a power platform. So currently we are the only Bulgarian partner recognized as a preferred power apps partner by Microsoft, and one of the very few in Central European region who has built their practices on top of the power apps and create their own IP products based on power platform and especially on power apps. So that's the reason we are discussing today, actually, and we can go further into details related to the topic of today's webinar. So we're going to talk about revolutions and especially the industrial one, but before this we have several major revolutions in the history and in a humankind evolution. So the first one 70,000 years ago was actually related to the cognitive revolution. So here actually these are the one that separate the sapient and the humankind from the today existing humankind of those who were on the planet back then. So then we have the first agricultural revolution 10,000 years ago, actually 12,000 years ago, and the last major kickoff of the industrial revolution back in 18th century. And what we're going to talk today is actually the natural follow-up of this first industrial revolution, started back in the mining industry and then continued to the mass production for Industry 2.0, Industry 3.0, related to automations and implementation of more and more of computer power in the manufacturing and industrial processes, and then going to Industry 4.0 nowadays, where with regards to terms, there are a lot of sources that could be found explaining the term in different directions with different contexts. So here we have a lot of materials from Gartner, PwC, Deloitte, and so on. But actually, what separates Industry 4.0 compared to Industry 3? It's actually the IoT, the artificial intelligence, mixed reality, who are the additional elements that put this new version on top of the previous one. So the IoT, the artificial intelligence, could be applied in different directions. So we're going to review three different subsets of Industry 4.0. This would be the smart cities, the smart technology, smart factories, and digital twins. They could be considered pretty much the same, with the major difference related to the size. So the size of the city, the size of the factory, the size of the digital twin. All of these could be mixed, and actually we can have a set of different smart factories related to each other. We can have a digital twins as part of the factory or part of the city, and we can have even smart factories within the city. So here the main difference could come out of the size of the object that we're gonna review as a subset of the Industry 4.0 and the industrial revolution that we are experiencing for the last more than decade. We're gonna review one of these subset, but again, it would be the same concept related to the other, but we will focus on digital twin as the most probably the smallest possible separate object that could be digitalized and go through the perspective of Industry 4.0. So we have the physical aspect of a certain object. It could be an asset, it could be a process, it could be the whole factory, like we said, it could be the city. So we have the physical part when we create the object, so we can build it, we can purchase it, we can lease it, then it starts to communicate with the rest of the world. Going from the digital part of this twin, then we can start collecting data from it. We can start analyze it. We can start making decisions and create insights out of the processes, out of the data, or out of the asset itself. And then we can go back to the physical world and start acting. So changing parameters of the machine, for example, or switching the production process, or moving the asset in some other physical location. And this goes on and goes on in circle, and the physical asset or the physical object sending data to the digital one, the digital twin aggregates this data, analyze it, putting some actionable insights there, and then send the act back to the physical object. So it's a life cycle management of these objects gone through the prism of digital twin. And it's the same, like I said, with the smart cities, with the smart factories, and so on. If we go in more details, what we see actually is this picture is presented by Deloitte in one of their reviews of Industry 4.0 and digital twins. So all of the processes and graphics there are pretty much the same from the different reviewers of this concept. But Deloitte are pretty familiar, so we decided to go with their perspectives for this webinar. So if we go in more details, based on the previous screen here, we have the physical process started and created from the very beginning. Then we have a different communication tools, sets, softwares, technologies like beacons or Bluetooth and so on. And through these communication sets, we can aggregate data in our digital twin, create actually the digital twin in our solutions, in our systems. We can have access to them via our web applications, mobile applications, you name it. Then you have actually the insights, the actionable insights based on notifications, based on KPIs for separate processes or for separate objects. We have the artificial intelligence and machine learning, the cognitive engines. We have all the data storages with the different layers and middleware integration sets, when we can continue the process again to other systems and solutions in the whole ecosystem. Because, for example, if we have an object, this object should be reviewed from all of their different perspectives. I mean, from supply chain, from operations, from maintenance, from finance, because when we talk about physical objects, in the many of the cases, they're actually fixed assets in the financial registers of the company. They are resources, part of the ERP solution of the company. So if we would like to produce and execute our production program and production schedule that we have, we rely on this asset or this set of assets to produce our goods. So they're integrated part of their ERP system, manufacturing execution systems, even their CAD models related to CPQ, pricing configuration, and quotation softwares, and many other contextual information related to the weather, related to the, if you like, with the current COVID situation and so on. And all of these different elements are actually integrated part of the whole management of the digital twin or the smart factory or the smart city. We'll go back to this picture later and see how we'll match it from technology perspective. But the important thing now is that even if you Google this topic or start searching for materials, there is a huge hype currently. So many of the trending topics are related to Industry 4.0, to the digital transformation, and so on. So a lot of different buzzwords related to this trending topics are available. There is a huge amount of materials from different publishers, like I mentioned, Deloitte, Gartner, PwC, Ernst & Young, all of the big four and second, third tier consultants or subject matter experts are writing huge amount of materials and book topics related to Industry 4.0. And still, when you try to search for real use cases, real customers, feedback from these customers, compared to the hype that you can find in the internet or on events, you name it, the difference is huge. So the number of actual customers implemented successfully and transitioned their organization from the third to the fourth version of this industry digitalization are so small. So you can read a lot. When you would like to see the customer reference, it's very hard to find it. And it's hard due to different reasons. Actually, infrastructure costs, but the integration costs are currently very high, and at least it was very high for couple of months or let's say quarters before. So it's too expensive to implement a digital twin or to move fast your digital transformation through the fourth industrial revolution. Also, it's too complex. So most of the companies, when they go deeper and deeper of their requirements and how they envision this solution to work related to collecting data or related to predictive maintenance, if you like, it's too complex. So they're focusing very much and very deeper on one particular object or set of objects instead of implement this concept broader and start actually doing something in this direction. So the business, the stakeholders, they are expecting return of investment, which could be very hard to be defined and defended budget-wise. Also, when we would like to moving business forward and also the IT forward, we need a very good bond between the IT guys and the business people. So this partnership is actually missing, and without IT and business going together in this transformation, it actually will never happen. The other main problems, like I mentioned on the previous slide, are the integrations. And the integration of this IoT, artificial intelligence, mixed reality technologies within the context of the full IT system or business landscape of the companies. So just for example, the integrations between ERP and CRM solutions with digital twins or with IoT solutions are so small, and here I'm not talking even for Bulgaria or Europe, I mean worldwide. And it's not possible for business to operate efficiently if their core systems, and within core systems I mean ERP, CRM, manufacturing execution systems, CPQs, warehouse management solutions, billing solutions, and so on, if they're not integrated in the context of IoT implementation. These integrations are, let's say, they're very hard, they're expensive, and but if they miss it, the whole concept of going to industry 4.0 is put on scrap. So you cannot continue further without having your ecosystem integrated and talking to each other. Not because the idea of IoT and the digital twin is to make people and objects talking in the same language. But if your backend systems are not talking as well in the same way, then the process is disturbed. And also the estimations for implementation of such solution, many of them are going to months, even years, most probably years. And it's a constraint to the business. So they would like to invest, they're required actually to invest to go to this new concept, but they don't have the good defined return of investment. They have a huge budget required to this implementation, and a very big amount of time that need to be invested before having any result. And just as a proof, here, thanks to Vasilena, our marketing lady, we collect many feedback from different customers, and what you see on the screen is actually feedback from maintenance engineer of one of the top three car manufacturers in the world. So they have a SAP as a ERP solution, they have an enterprise asset management solution implemented, but still, these solutions are not talking to each other in the most efficient way required to execute the business processes smoothly. And here we are not talking about small company. Here we are talking about a company with thousands of employees and billions of revenue. So even they're experiencing these problems that we are talking in this session. So the smart factory, smart manufacturing, smart digital twins as a concept, they are still not implemented there. So they have, for example, the virtual model of their objects, assets, or in this case, cars, but they're not collecting data in the way that they need it from. Are still not there, and there is a reason for this. So what's next, and why actually the topic of this webinar is related not to Industry 4.0, which is traditional approach and hype and Google words that you can find a lot of information related to it, but we're talking about the next version. The next version is the one who actually adds the missing ingredients and requirements that are able to make Industry 4.0 actually working and applicable. So there are two major factors, and the first one, and let's say it could be best as a requirement, is to make this concept applicable to the businesses and to different industries. And another KPI that should be related to this requirement is actually to start measuring different KPIs. And we're talking about time to value. So we need to measure when we have our investment returned and start gaining the benefits, instead of calculating how much the ROI would be in a certain period, because this calculation is proven that currently is not working and is one of the major obstacles to going into this direction of the digital transformation. So here we're talking about changing the mindset, but this change is a result of we need to have the approach and tools to make this fourth industrial revolution applicable and accessible to different businesses. And another key thing is that the consumer of this service, it could be a worker in our factory, it could be a maintenance guy or technician, or even the finance department, or it could be an end user or subscriber for a certain service or product, they're consumers. And they also need to be involved in this process. So they are part of the full landscape, and they're also generators of data, behavior, feedback, and so on. So they need to be part of this revolution. Otherwise, you're going in a direction which is not sure is the right one. So the idea is that this revolution is not a one-time off. It's a repeatable process, and need to be adjusted every time with every circle. So if I may refer to the previous slide when we saw all the analyze, insight, act, communicate, and so on, this is a repeatable process. So every time when we go through it, we need to measure, and we need to adjust if it's necessary. It's the same here with the consumer, and we need to put it in this circle and take its feedback opinion and adjust our industrial revolution processes and the digital transformation as a whole. So this was the actually the introduction to the today's problem that that we have, and then we will go to the technical part. So if you have any questions, we can make a short discussion now before continue further. I'm just checking the chat session. Nothing there. Anyone would like to add something? To agree or disagree?
Ask, do you think the current knowledge about Industry 4.0 is enough to be translated and then applied to the journey of transitioning to Industry 4.1?
If I believe if we have the right relationship and partnership between the business people and the IT people, then the required skill set as a team is there to make this transition.
Okay.
Any other questions now? Okay, maybe later, so we can continue with the rest of the webinar. I believe we are good with time. Okay, moving to the technical perspective of the full thing. So how we'll move the companies currently in the stage of the third industrial revolution to the fourth one successfully. The main problems there was related to lack of communication, like we said, related to the time and budget constraints, to the resource constraints, and also to measurable results. So what we see is actually the Power Platform and their key players here in our scenario, Power Apps and Power Automate, as the right tool set which could actually empower this transition for the different industries and make this 4.1 concept really accessible and applicable for the businesses. Let's make us a quick summary of the platform, because more and more we talk about Microsoft Power Platform as a whole, not as a separate element like it was before. You will see afterwards why, but let's make a quick review. So we have the Power BI. It's a more familiar tool for the last 6 or 7 years. It's a business analytics, business intelligence tool that could be very efficient and even self-service. It's in the leader quadrant of Gartner reports. Now we have Power Apps, which is the tool for application development. And here we are talking about low-code application development. Also Power Automate, it's a workflow automation tool, so you can make all the integrations and other things within tool. And we have the latest addition. We will put it a bit aside for now, but it would be more and more popular in the future. So we are talking about Power Virtual Agents, which are chatbots that could be applied in many different customer scenarios. We have a common data service, which is the backend and database and data model and many other things that we will review. But let's say that this is the backbone where all the information is collected, and we can apply additional business logic on this database. We have the data connectors, so we can make these applications that we have developed talking to the rest of the systems and solutions within the customer organizations. And we also have the AI builder, so the artificial intelligence builder that could work for us in a different scenarios with different predefined AI models that we will review a bit later. So if we need to summarize today, we'll review in more details these main elements of the Power Platform, focusing on Power Apps with the assistance of Power Automate and Power BI. So the idea is to have application development way more accessible to the business and communicating with the different solutions, applications, mobile or web softwares within the organization to have the data that we can analyze and make some decision making, start new processes based on this data and actually moving the business forward. So these are the key players within the Power Platform. And we will review each one of them from its own perspective. But like I said, many of the things are connected. And even if you're using Power Apps, you use common data service for sure. You use data connectors and some flows, part of Power Automate. If you're using Power BI, as a standalone solution, again, you use some other Power Platforms tools and services in the background. So it's an interconnected platform. But starting from Power Apps, like I mentioned, it's a platform for low-code development of web and mobile applications. You can customize different, in this case, Microsoft solutions, but you're not limited only to them. You can create your own applications, standalone, or even a set of different applications working on the same data set. We have multiple different connectors for different online and offline services, on-premise solutions, and this number that you see on the screen, currently there are 300 plus, but the growth rate, I believe, is something like 10 to 15% per quarter. So last year, same time, I believe there was something like 170 or 180, something like this. So the number is growing every day and every week. We have the AI builder. So from the previous slide, you saw that this is part of the Power Platform, but it's actually integral part of Power Apps particularly. So we can create AI models, intelligence through cognitive services to predictive models and so on. So it's part of the Power Apps platform. And when we are talking about creating solutions with Power Apps, they are actually enterprise ready. So one of the objections for the last years with regards to low-code development platforms was actually that these are not enterprise ready platforms, and the solutions that you have there are, let's say, small applications created by some shadow IT guys that it's not in the context of the organization. So this is not the discussion anymore. So Microsoft particularly put a lot of efforts with regards to make this platform aligned with all the enterprise requirements, security, application lifecycle management, governance, aligned with their full business applications portfolio. So actually, when you start a new PowerApps project, by default, the application you will create, if you're not messed something, of course, would be enterprise ready and applicable for really mature companies with a rich ecosystem of applications in their organizations. And also, like I mentioned, this is not a no-code platform, development platform, but it's a low-code. And it's a low-code because it allows professional developers to extend the functionality and create their specific custom controls and custom components within this application. So the idea is that such kind of platform could empower the citizen developers and business users to be integral part of the creation of new apps and new solutions. But you also open this platform to the professional developers who can actually speed up their development processes and focus on adding additional value in the platform and in the applications that we're going to create. So the other element here is the Power Automate. So this is the tool that could make different applications, different databases, and different solutions talking to each other. So the idea is to have one point of entry of collecting data or entering data, and then the automate would make possible to transfer this data across different instances, platforms, databases, you name it. So here, like majority of the automation tools, we have the triggers, we have the business logic implemented in this process, and then we have the action. So in let's say it's a very easy workflow modeling, you can create such kind of automation that in the traditional development approach actually would require development of different integrations, interfaces between systems, using of different services and tools to make this integration possible. So it's not the case with Power Automate anymore. So even the business users and not a professional developer could make integration between different solutions. And I will talk about a bit later about these integrations in the context of Industry 4.1. Also, we will see a scenario for robotic process automation a bit later. But this is the tool that could spend a lot of time integrating solutions and actually make this this integration really happening. Even if we are talking about legacy systems with no APIs and so on. So the other element here is the common data service as a part of the Power Platform. Microsoft like to position this solution as not just a database, because it makes a lot of other things, and like it was mentioned, it's the backbone of many different solutions built on Power Apps, but not only, because just as an example, the Common Data Service, or CDS, is the database behind Microsoft Dynamics 365 and all of the CRM modules part of these solutions. So one of the biggest CRM solutions in the world actually are working on the same database. And another example, if we have a customer of Dynamics 365 and we have a same customer with PowerApps, they can even work in the same database and sharing the same data. So like I said, it's not just a database, but also common data service has all the security tools that we can make our tool really, really secure. We can apply business logic there and business workflows in the CDS, on a CDS level. We have all the data that can be collected, not only from our applications, but from automation integrations through Power Automate and other APIs as well. So we have the storage there, and we have all the integration tools within this common data service as well. And it would make our applications and even the IoT solutions really working on this service. And then we have the AI Builder. It was released by Microsoft as a part of the Power Platform, especially part of PowerApps end of last year. So here we have an integrated tool that we can use to create our own artificial intelligence models based on a specific scenarios. Based on a specific logic that we can put into the model. We can train it, we can continue training with every iteration, and we can actually make it work for us and have a real AI builder and AI models implemented in the organization in a democratized way, so the business users from the customer perspective could be part of the development process of these artificial intelligence models. As a start, what we have in the AI Builder is the binary classification, so we can predict events and we can use the data that we have in common data service collected from different places. We can apply the AI models based on this data and predict certain events or numbers or you name it that we can have in the future. So the prediction and the binary classification is one of the things we can play with the AI Builder. There are other things related to the cognitive services are the form processing and object detection. Just for an example, we had an inquiry for a big manufacturer of drinks where they like to have an application to scan the, for example, the broken part on the production line. Then based on this object detection to make a request to the warehouse and see if we have some spare parts, in which warehouse are they, and to make a reservation for this specific spare part. So different scenarios could be reviewed here. And also we have the text classification, and it's not just the OCR, but it's a OCR with applied logic and text sentiment and so on. So we have this tool embedded in PowerApps and working with all the other elements with the Power Automate, with the CDS and rest of the services. Like I mentioned, we need to have the consumers part of our industry digitalization and revolution. So here we have portals that could actually extend our apps and our databases to the rest of the stakeholders. So we can open in a secure way, of course, we can open our solutions to the end users. We can open it to our partners, to our vendors or manufacturers, and other related parties within the process of asset management or supply chain or facility management, for example. Again, a lot of the elements here are the same. So we can have the pro developers extending and working in the same environment and adding additional features when we have some limitations based on the platform. It's not necessary to provision licenses or access and so on to identify our contributors and portal users, so they can log in with their LinkedIn account or other authentication services. So it's a very useful and really for a day or two, we can build a very complex portal, actually working with the same business processes and data we are using in our organization. One of the latest addition, it's part of Power Automate, actually, are the robotic process automation scenarios. So the RPA, it's existing on the market for last maybe 5 years, but Microsoft actually implemented it as a part of the Power Platform recently. So we have a different scenarios here where we can have attended and unattended bots that are actually trained and working instead of the workers. So the idea here is for the people and for the employees to focus on really high valuable actions and tasks and leave the repeatable work, the low added value tasks to the bot. This is also a way where we can integrate legacy solutions with no APIs and no integration capabilities, and to have the bot having and taking the information from one of the systems and place it in another or in our Power Up solution, for example. So we can have a different scenarios here for attended and unattended bots and robots. So like I said, it's one of the very latest additions within the platform. And like we mentioned, we can put all of the stakeholders in our creation of Industry 4.1 solutions, applications, portals, robots, chatbots, and automated workflows. So we can have the business users, the so-called citizen developers in our team. We can have the IT professionals and in also the professional developers. And in this way, we have a team capable together to actually create our smart factory or digital twin or even the smart city. Talking about digital twins, Azure, what we have in Azure currently and what we rely on is the IoT hub and the IoT services that are integral part of Azure. Currently, what we have in a preview is the so-called Azure Digital Twins, who in mainly they will also be based on the Azure IoT and on the IoT concept with some additions. So you can check in the internet and in, actually it's in official in the site of website of Azure, but it's still in preview. We can check different scenarios that could be covered with this solution, again in the context of full revolution of the industry. So let's make the summary. We have the Power Platform with its different elements. I haven't reviewed the Power BI because it's a very familiar tool and it's not necessary to go into deeper details about it, but yeah, very sophisticated business intelligence and business analytics tool that we have as a part of the Power Platform. We reviewed the apps and Automate for application development and workflow automation. we briefly mentioned about the Power Virtual Agents, but yeah, the chatbot concept is very applicable these days. So we can also play with these tools as well and connect to the consumers that we talk about in the same way that we can interact with them via the portals. We have the common data service and the data connectors. We have the AI builder, but we also have the Azure services in the context of the full digitalization and realization of IoT scenarios in our Industry 4.1 strategy. So if we go back to this picture from the very beginning and the first part of the webinar, we have the full process from physical to digital with all the elements and cycling process from create, communicate, aggregate, analyze, insight, act, and again and again and again. And if we need to match what we have from technology perspective, we have exactly the Azure services, the Azure IoT Hub, and Power Automate when we can communicate and collect data from the physical assets. Then we have Power Apps where we can actually create our digital twin or our model or in the place where we'll collect data, apply logic, and we can have it on a multiple devices. So we can have a portal, we can have a web application for internal usage, we can have a mobile application, we can have application embedded in Teams, even the tool that we're using now. We have notifications to the different stakeholders. We will use Power BI to visualize and analyze data and dashboards alongside with Power Apps. We have the AI builder where we can apply AI models, cognitive recognition, and have it in the same common data service, which could be used as a data lake, as a data storage and middleware that could collect data from different places, not only from the digital twin, but also, for example, from the contextual information that we can have from the social medias, from the sensors, temperature forecasts, and so on. And we also have, again, Azure and Power Automate to communicate with the rest of the softwares in the company. So we can integrate easily with the ERP solutions, with the CRM solutions within the customer, with to send information to sensors and actuators on the machine itself, and to have this full circle closed from very beginning to the very end, and have the integration between all the required systems in the context of this object management integrated via our solutions. So just for example, because the majority of the cases we are talking about integration with the ERP solution, by default in Power Automate, we have integration with Microsoft Dynamics ERPs, both of the versions. We have also integration with SAP, with Oracle databases. So all the major players are part of the automation tool by default, because the connections, the connectors are already there. And of course, you can build custom connectors within the same Power Automate scenario. So like you can see on the screen, actually we have within Power Apps and the rest of the Power Platform players, of course, everything is by default built on Azure, because the Power Platform itself, it's in Azure. Alongside with additional Azure services, we can cover all the missing links between the physical asset, the physical object, and physical processes. To the new concept of digital twins and Industry 4.1, and have this in the full context of the software solutions that are already existing in the organization, and make really this new concept applicable and accessible for the businesses. Even if you like, you can check the pricing of power-ups on Microsoft website. So it's a really accessible solution for different sizes of businesses, starting from small companies and small logistics or manufacturing businesses or utilities to really large enterprises. It's also the case for us, because like I mentioned, we develop a product, and this product is focused on enterprise asset management, and the digital twin concept, and the technologies that we are having in Power Apps and Power Platform. Actually, for the last months, we put a lot of efforts to develop this concept and develop this solution in this direction, so we can really have the asset intensive industries, which are the majority of the businesses who could apply the digital twins or the smart factories or digitalization of their processes and run through the digital transformation, really applicable and accessible. Most probably in June, we will have dedicated webinars with regards to the solution and with regards to the, again, to the technology that we're using with way more details and demo scenarios. But it would be next month, so we can use even our solution as a proof of concept of what we are talking about today, because Sappience is a company fully relies on the Power Platform and the different tools that we saw today to really have this picture fulfilled from technical perspective and then actually deliver the... someone is unmuted. Okay, some noises, but if someone is asking a question, I wasn't able to hear it. Okay, muted again. So, we went through 4.1, but yeah, the question here, and it's a topic for discussion, even if what we have nowadays with all the revolution and all the AI cognitive recognition solutions and technologies available on the market. We need to make it applicable, but if we go back to the start of this presentation where we talk about the cognitive revolution 70,000 years ago, if today we are talking about the second cognitive recognition revolution, or we are going back. And I tried to find the word of opposite of the revolution. So devolution is actually not the word. So counter-revolution, and even if we're going there. So we'll see. But yeah, let's use this as a opening the discussion and see if we have some Q&A on the first part or even on the second part of the webinar today.